My name is Tassos and I'm with RF Elements. And today I'll be talking to you about our technology for fast sustainable wireless, also giving you some vendor updates and product updates on where we are today and kind of where we're going. So we want to talk a little bit about the channel strategy that we have, right, as we're moving forward. We're growing as a company. Things are evolving. Things are very dynamic right now. So in 2017, we implemented a new strategy to help improve product availability and coverage, right? So we're doing a lot internally, not only with our products, but from the business standpoint and how we do business in order to, you know, give you better services, right? So we've gone to a new multi-tier distributor channel structure globally, right? So we have master distributors, regular distributors, and then we have resellers. So this is a way for us to ensure that product is in your region and available, you know, through multiple channels. We've also created some tools to help you, and one of those is our stock locator, which you can find on our website. So if you go to our website, available on our homepage, you can go to stock locator. And it automatically defaults to your region, but you have the ability to also go and pick other regions. Basically, you just pick the product type that you want, you pick the region that you need it in, and it'll show you in real time what distributors have them and the link to their website so you can actually see how many they have and what the pricing is. So this is kind of a different way of doing things rather than, you know, filling out a form and having, you know, 100 distributors or people start emailing you, hey, I have stock. You can actually see it in real time. So it's a way to make your job more efficient, because we know when you're bidding jobs and you're trying to build out new things, you need to know right away and you don't have time to wait for emails. So use our stock locator on our website. We also have the distributor search. So if you're curious to know who's a distributor in your area, you can go to the distributor search and you can globally see, again, all the distributors we have worldwide for our products. Supply chain. So this has changed for us as well. So, you know, we're constantly increasing our production and capacity to match the demand. And I thank all of you, the ones that have been using it, for supporting us. But again, we have to change kind of our business to kind of modernize and catch up to the demand that's out there. So we're doing a lot of things to increase production. We're diversifying our supply chain. And right now we're transitioning to where pretty much 90% of the product is going to be assembled in Asia. We sourced our parts before from Asia, that hasn't changed, but we were actually assembling and testing in Slovakia and Europe, and now we're moving that to be more efficient, to be able to deliver the products when you need it and where you need it. We're doing that all through Asia, but it's all covered with our employees doing quality control as well. So we're still maintaining very high levels of quality, which you guys demand from us, and we will not ever, you know, kind of drop down to the level of, you know, delivering poor quality. So that's one of the number one things that we want to do. So it's being assembled in Asia to help better fill the supply chain. So we temporarily had some delays in product in Q2 and Q3. Again, it was because of this transition. I know we announced products last year that were supposed to come out early this year. And again, in trying to grow and meet the demand, you know, we stumbled a little, right? So those things are being ironed out. So moving forward, we should see pretty good product availability, and you should start seeing the ramping up of the new products that we have coming down the pipe. So in Q4 of this year, right now, supply chain is pretty much worked out. So things should start flowing pretty good. Another thing that we're doing is we're starting up a Twistport developer program. So what does that mean for WISPs? It may not mean as much, but it does lead to something. See, we have this vision and we have this dream for where this industry needs to go from the equipment standpoint, right? And it has to do with the twist port. It has to do with the lossless connector. You really need all these mechanisms. You need the noise rejection of our antennas. You need the zero loss of the twist port adapter, that waveguide interface. This is the magic. Putting it all together is really what delivers these solutions to work. It's not just one or the other. You can't just have a horn and your network is going to be great. It's really bringing all these things together. So what we're doing is we're creating a new licensing program for third-party manufacturers, which could be very exciting for you guys. You might start seeing other manufacturers now potentially creating radio platforms that are compatible with our Twistport ecosystem, right? We get, you know, a lot from people saying, well, why don't you make a Twistport for this, you know, for this radio? I want to see it for this radio. I ask you to talk to your manufacturers of the radios you prefer and say, why don't you have a Twistport adapter to work with our antennas, right? So this is kind of one of the first steps, letting you know that you may start seeing radio systems from other vendors now becoming compatible without the adapter straight to our antennas. So this is one of our next steps. New products or product updates. So the UltraDish, again, this is something that we showed last year. Again, it fell into the whole delays of this transitioning in the supply chain. Again, our UltraDish does still have best-in-class beam performance. It doesn't have zero side lobes like our horn antenna technology does, but in the parabolic dish regime of antennas, it's got really good side lobe suppression and really good chain-to-chain performance, which is important. So if we look at the horizontal and vertical beam performance, which is, again, the key in MIMO technology, you'll see that our vertical and horizontal still match gain across the spectrum, which is really important. So when you're changing channels, you're not dropping performance because the antenna is not tuned well for that gain at that particular part of the spectrum. Again, with our Twistport technology, so any of the Twistport adapters and radios that you're using right now with our horns, perhaps, are perfectly compatible with our dish parabolic antennas. We've made some changes as well, so we've updated design. The mounting system is slightly different. We have a new, better ergonomic handle. The dish itself is redefined from the last version that you saw. So all in all, you're getting slightly better performance out of the rev that we're shipping now in October versus the version that you saw last time. So availability is October of 2017. The 24 dB version, our UltraDish 400, will be $99 MSRP from distributors. And our UltraDish 550, which is the 27 dB version, will be $129. And that's for the parabolic dish. You add the Twistport adapter and the radio of your choice. So, you know, again, we have a wide array of adapters, and we'll talk a little bit about that next. So our UltraHorn, right? This is probably the biggest product release that we have and what people are really waiting for. So again, as far as this antenna goes, we've made some big changes. So you still have the ultimate beam performance, right? So it's perfect, you know, symmetrical. It's about 15 degrees beam width, but it's perfect chain-to-chain performance, just like our other symmetrical horn antennas. So you're getting the best beam performance and the ultimate noise rejection. So if you look on the left, again, this is what the, you know, complex side lobes of a parabolic dish look like on the left compared to UltraHorn. So there really is, there's no comparison between the two. It's extremely precise, and the radiation angle is much more precise than you would get with a parabolic dish, even with shielding shrouds put on them. There's no comparison. Again, if we look at the noise rejection, on the left is a parabolic dish. You can see the very complex side lobes that are coming out the sides compared to an UltraHorn that, again, has zero side lobes and no back radiation. So the performance is fantastic. We've changed the design a little bit. So if you, again, I don't know who saw the original one last year, but the current version that's going to be shipping now is actually 43% smaller in volume. So we took a lot of the feedback that you guys got, and the first thing was, dude, that thing is huge, right? So we said, let's make it smaller. So we were able to make it more compact. We were able to redesign the mount and do some product changes and still maintain that same 24 dB of gain that we had. So in the end, you have a perfectly performing antenna that's much smaller, more compact for you to use. So again, Twistport technology. So the UltraHorn will work with every Twistport adapter that we have. So it doesn't matter which radio platform you're using, a Twistport adapter will work, whether it's Microtech and router boards, if you're using Ubiquiti, if you're using Cambian EPMP 1000, and now the C5C from Mimosa. So many different Twistport adapters that are available work with all our Twistport antennas. ultimate beam performance again. So if you look at the performance from 5 to 6 gigahertz, you can see that the chain-to-chain performance and the performance across the spectrum is pretty flat. So you're not going to see these spikes and fall off at 5.1 and great performance at 5.7. It's pretty much pretty smooth across the board. So that helps. The mount has been redesigned, right? So it's a much sturdier mount than we had. Again, it's really easy, kind of flowing with our drop-in and smooth styling for the way the bolts line up and everything like that. So integrated handle, it's adjustable, it's removable. So a lot of things have changed again in the mounting system for adjusting azimuth and angle and elevation. And if we look at all the components again, it's basically, it is built like a tank, it really is. Everything is made out of either aluminum or zinc, right? So there will be no rust on these things. They're perfectly suitable for outdoor deployments and a very, very high quality. So the availability for the Ultra Horn is this December. Again, we have a 21 dB version and a 24 dB version, and the prices are $349 MSRP for the 24 and $269 for the 21 dB version. New adapters. So we started shipping the Mimosa C5C adapter. So I don't know how many people use Mimosa, but this will be great with our Ultra Dish or even an Ultra Horn for CPE, probably Ultra Dish. Great new addition to our twist port line. The EPMP 2000, this is something that we heard so much feedback from you guys. We initially weren't going to do it because the form factor is large, right? And you guys just kept screaming for it, so we delivered. So we have the EPMP 2000 twist port adapter. It's gonna be available this month as well, and the MSRP is gonna be $44.90. Twist port adapter for the ISO and Prism station. So if you guys love the performance of your Ubiquiti Prism stations or ISO stations, and you care to use them with a true symmetrical horn antenna, now you can. So with this adapter, you just snap it on, and now makes those radio platforms also compatible with all of our twist port antennas, whether it's the dish, the horns, it doesn't matter. So one simple adapter, you connect it, and you're able to use them with all of our twist port antennas. Availability date is November, and MSRP is gonna be about $19.90 for that adapter. Webinars. So we've been working on a bunch of new webinars. So we'll put them on our website. So some of the new ones that are coming out are migrating to horns, right? This is one of the biggest things. It's one of the number one question I deal with is, how do I transition from sector antennas to horn antennas? You know, what do I have to do? So this is gonna be a great webinar to hopefully help direct you and answer those questions. Deploying horn antennas, again, it's another great webinar that's gonna help answer the questions that a lot of people have as far as how do you use them, how do you aim them, you know, what's the proper down tilt and all this kind of stuff. Increasing throughput 101, this is again another one to show you how the horn antennas can help you increase throughput overall to your towers and your deployments. And then a deep dive into our twist port waveguide port, right, to kind of help you understand more how this technology truly works and how you benefit from them. So all these new webinars are coming online soon. You'll be able to go to our website and sign up for them, and we'll hope to push some new information to you guys. We also have a new link calculator. So I don't know how many people have tried the original link calculator, still there, but we've now added multi-CPE portions to our link calculator. So you can actually add multiple CPEs to your map. You can drop them, you have the beam angles, you just click from the list, drop down which horn antenna you want, you drop it on the map where the tower is, and you can start dropping your CPEs in there, and it'll tell you what the signal strengths are, what the MCS rates you should be able to achieve, and help you better plan out your sites. You can meet us or ask us to visit you, right? So we love dealing, interacting, and I love to talk, if you haven't noticed. So I love meeting you guys and talking to you guys and hearing about the questions that you have and helping you. So we'd love to come, you know, visit you or have you guys come visit us, right? So, you know, come check out our website to see what events we're doing. And like I said, if you have special needs for us to come visit you, that's a possibility too. So reach out and, you know, get in touch with us, and we'll see what we can work out. And then stay tuned. So again, you know, being plugged into our social media feeds is probably one of the best ways of getting the information from us to you, right? So we're on practically every platform. YouTube is great. Go to our YouTube channel. There's tons and tons of videos from actual customers, right? Customers explaining how they used our technology and how it benefits them. So a lot of information there. On Facebook is great for interacting again with customers that are using it and even us. Google+, LinkedIn, Twitter, a lot of places to go where you can get information about our products or interact with people in our company. And with that, we'll go to questions. So if anybody has a question, I'm happy to answer anything. I don't know if the mic works up there, but I may be able to hear you without it. So if anybody has a question, yes.
As far as I can see, it's all 5 gig. Is there any other frequencies for your antennas?
Yeah, so yes, you're right. Currently, it is all 5 gig. We have a roadmap to go beyond 5 gig. Those frequencies are not announced yet, but yes, there's definitely, it's on the roadmap. We kind of have to finish our product portfolio. We wanted the point to multipoint. Now we're doing point to point, and then after that, I think you'll start seeing new products come out in different frequencies. Yes? The PMP450, I believe, is a really big radio, right? So for that radio, we have the carrier class antenna line. So we currently have it in our horn antennas, right? So you just get the connectorized version and you can connect it to any antenna or any 5 gig radio system that doesn't have a twist port for it. You will also see the Ultra Horn and the Ultra Dish come out in the carrier class line as well. So you will have connectorized versions for, again, radio platforms that don't integrate with a twist port adapter.
Quick follow-up on that. What are people using? Because obviously, at this point, two degrees matters.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a tough one. I mean, people are doing it in all different ways, and really it's the rest of the users you need to speak to, the people who are using the horns. The most common practice that I've seen is, they take a pipe and they just draw the line at 0 and 180, and they just draw where the 45 is and the 30, and they kind of use lines down the pipe in order to try and figure it out. So yeah, that's kind of difficult for me to answer that directly. No. So the antenna performance is identical, right? I mean, you still kind of have the same interface. Really, the only performance difference, perhaps, or the thing that you should pay attention to the most, is buy high quality interface cables. That's what we all can say. So of course you want as short as possible. So try not to get a 10 meter long cable when it only needs to be 3 feet or something like that. But really, it's the quality of the cable. So get it from a reputable manufacturer of cables. Don't just go on Amazon and order because it says LMR 400 with an end connector, it's going to be good, right? So that's the only difference. But the antenna performance is identical. Yeah.
Radome availability for the dishes?
I don't have an answer for that. Are we going to do radomes for the dishes? I mean, we've been asked, right? So it's a possibility. It's not something that's on the immediate roadmap, but it's definitely, we've heard people ask for it, so. Any other questions?
You said on your carrier class you're going to have the Ultra Horn.
Yeah.
But it wasn't on your map, any kind of time frame?
It should only be 30, 60 days after. Yeah, so another month or so. We have to get the twist port version tooled up and shipped, and then we'll have the carrier class. Hopefully here within the next 30 days, you should start seeing the Ultra Horn and some of these new products showing up on distributors' websites as well for pre-orders and stuff like that. So there'll be some progress here definitely in the next 30 days.
I'm just curious if there's a reason why you have the carrier class horns rather than a end connector twist port adapter.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a tough one. So I get this question. I get this question a lot, right?
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, so really, there's there's not necessarily a need for a connectorized twist port. I know from the conceptual, it makes a lot of sense, but really, what radio are you going to use, right? If you're going to use a huge clunky radio like a 450 or something that just has no ability to have a twist port adapter, buy the carrier class version, right? So if you're going to use a radio that has a small form factor and we have a twist port, get the twist port version. So there's a lot of arguments on why we should have one, and I know from the conceptual point, it makes sense. The one most common thing is, well, I could just buy twist port horns and I could just have a few connectorized end connectors for those times when I want. But really, when you're planning out these higher end radios as well, that's not something that you just say tomorrow, hey, I'm going to go do it, right? There's time, so you're going to buy the proper antenna for the radio that you're using. So I had one question over here earlier. No? Okay. So we've done a lot, right? So even if you look at our carrier class sector, the one that has the built-in shielding and stuff, we've kind of gone, I guess you can say, the same way with the UltraDish. For a parabolic antenna, we've created as best performance as you can get from that platform, right? No matter what you do, you're going to have side lobes. Yes, you can put shrouds. Could it benefit from it? Probably, right? However, there's a bigger underlining issue when you start putting this shielding on antennas, you start creating other problems, right? So if you can create a parabolic dish antenna that suppresses side lobes naturally as best as possible, you're probably better off than creating new reflections and warping your main beam signal. So we'd rather leave that up to somebody else to create a shield if they want, or some shroud for our parabolic than us doing it, probably. So, yes?
Do you have any kind of a pointing tool that would help out? Because we get up on the thing and where the guy on the tower is behind it, and it's difficult for him to see where he's actually really pointing.
Sure. So this kind of goes along with what the guy asked in the back as far as alignment goes and how to figure out where you put two horns together to cover subsequent areas. So there's something in the works to hopefully help you guys to do this. Yeah. Any other questions? Nope. Well, thank you. I appreciate you guys taking out the time to hear us. Again, if you haven't used our product or seen our product, please come by booth 413, and I'd be happy to talk to all of you individually and answer some more direct questions if you have them as well. Thank you again.